What's your name?
Jen O'Neill.
And what brings you here today?
So I'm here to protest SOPA and PIPA, which directly threaten the freedom of the internet.
And why is it threatening the internet?
So what it would do is shut down websites that have any information that could be deemed as copyright infringement. So for example, we have a website with users in 200 countries, and they use Tripping, which is our site, to share content and information with each other. So for example, we might have someone who posts their favorite video on Tripping, and they want to share that with someone in another country. Well, what would happen is SOPA could step in and shut down our website.
Explain it pretty well.
The government could step in, not SOPA.
So anyway, the concern is that your webpage, which, can you give us the webpage again?
Sure. So our website is Tripping, and we have members in...
Tripping.com.
Tripping.com, thank you. And they have members in, and we have members in 200 countries, and they use Tripping to connect with each other both in real life and online. So
what is your average user? I mean, what are your users using Tripping for? I mean, besides, like, you know, what they wouldn't do on Facebook, for example.
Sure. So with Tripping, you can get on a plane, fly to 200 countries, and meet a local person who will take you out for a beer, invite you into their homes to cook a meal together, let you stay.
Oh wow, okay.
Yeah, let you stay with them for free.
It's like not B2B, but friend to friend.
Sort of.
Kind
yeah,
of.
Yeah.
Okay.
So it's all about cultural exchange and learning about other people and other cultures. So the way that SOPA and PIPA would affect us is they would make it impossible or very difficult for our members to share information with each other, and so it would break down a lot of that cross-cultural connections. That
but why, if I share, let's say, a video with somebody in Madrid, why would SOPA come into play here?
So the government, unless you created the video yourself, the government could step in and say, well, that's copyrighted information, and you're not allowed to distribute that.
But if I created the video myself, then it wouldn't be copyrighted.
If you do create it by yourself, it's fine. Yeah, okay. That's okay. But if you, let's say you have a favorite clip of a Giants game or something like that, and you want to share that with someone, the government could step in and say, you're not allowed to share that, and not only prohibit you from doing it, but actually affect our business and shut us down.
But I mean, if you just said that this type of content is not allowable, then why would that not fix that?
We could say that, yeah. So we could prohibit our users from sharing content like that. But the way we see it is, it really breaks down just the freedom of people being able to share their cultures, right? So for example, San Francisco Giants are a big part of San Francisco culture, and if you want to share that with someone who maybe lives in Spain, you wouldn't be able to share that, and so you wouldn't be able to teach them about maybe baseball and what it means to you here.
SOPA, let's say one of your... How many users do you have?
No, we actually don't say that publicly, but we
okay.
have
Okay, but you have lots of users.
Yeah,
yes, you have lots of users.
Yeah.
Okay, so it would be, and I presume that the number of people that are at your company is fairly small, so you could,
seven of you,
and you got, let's say, 1 million users.
Uh-huh.
There's no way that you could ever police...
Well, that's exactly it. It would be very difficult for us to go in and police everything that's being shared on Tripping. It would be impossible.
And one violation would shut you down.
Shut us down without due process, from what we understand.
That would be very concerned. That's the reason why you're concerned.
That's absolutely why we're concerned, yeah.
And
today there is a blackout, so I don't know if you're posting this online today, but encourage people to go to Reddit.com, Wikipedia, sites like that, and you'll see that they've all been blacked out for the day. No, just, you know, thank you for being here, for bringing this out, like telling people what's going on, and I would just encourage people to pay attention because this affects everyone, not just people in Silicon Valley.
Well, thank you very much for your time.
Yeah, thank you.
We're good. So, what's your name?
My name is Jessica Borja.
And we're here at the Civic Center in San Francisco at the end of the SOPA protest. And you came down here because you're concerned about the SOPA, proposed SOPA law and PIPA law. What is it that you are concerned about?
Specifically, I'm starting to see that a large amount of music blogs would be shut down due to the fact that if SOPA or PIPA were actually to pass through Congress or the House. A lot of music is more or less waiting to be discovered based on the large platform that is the internet. We no longer have to rely on large record labels in order to present us the content. Instead, we have to actually find the content ourselves, which, you know, adds to the popularity of Pandora, adds to the popularity of YouTube, when you can actually just go in and search a song and listen to it whenever you'd like. In fact, speaking of YouTube, I found a great documentary that I would have not otherwise seen unless I'd actually stumbled upon it on YouTube called The Ascent of Man, which gave this great analogy. during the scientific revolution of the Renaissance, the Vatican shut down Galileo for trying to more or less spread the word that we do in fact revolve around the sun, which we now know is true.
And they tried to censor him.
Yes, they in fact did effectively censor him and most of his writings afterwards. The scientific revolution didn't stop or die. It just moved northward from Italy to England, where it was a more liberal Protestant era, as liberal as Protestants can get. That said, you start seeing the innovations of Newton, you start seeing the innovations of a lot more Northern European scientists that really just spurred on the revolution and brought us to the society that we're at today. Doing, more or less shutting down the internet as we know it and censoring it would be like jailing Galileo, at least here. Mm-hmm. The innovation will just move elsewhere. And right now, this is an area that is seeing unprecedented job growth. Someone can actually come here and start their own company and see some success in it because they have original ideas. And this is the same with bands as well. More people are actually basing their music on content instead of image.
Could you tell us a little bit about yourself? I mean, are you a music blogger, or are you in the tech industry?
I'm actually hoping to enter both. I'm currently writing for listenbeforeyoubuy.net, which is its own little music site. And of course, I have my own personal music blog. I do like to talk about music with other people online.
What's your what's the website of your music blog?
Edgy at best. It's edgyatbest.tumblr.com.
Okay.
And
how do you spell that?
edgyatbest.tumblr.com.
Great.
That said, there's a large amount of music that I would have never discovered if it weren't for sites like Bandcamp or SoundCloud or even other music blogs that more or less would present music that otherwise wouldn't relatively be known in mainstream music. The idea of mainstream and independence is almost an archaic model in itself. You have a lot more bands that would be considered mainstream music that have independent roots. You have bands that are no longer functioning so much on the garage, but they're functioning on the internet. They will present their music and then ask that you pay whatever that you wish you pay. And if you really do genuinely like the music, you'll start hearing more and more about them, which is what we do at most music blogs and music sites.
Yeah.
Something like this would just more or less push it back to the model where, look, I'll tell you, growing up as a kid in the 90s, I was bored with NSYNC. I was bored with a large amount of the music that was more or less pushed on me, either by record labels, and having no other content, you know, being a kid, I can't really go to music or nightclubs to try to find the music myself. The internet was really what opened myself musically.
Mm-hmm.
Finding new artists, new content that I, you know, in Georgia, in the middle of Georgia, or in the middle of Massachusetts or in the middle of Pennsylvania, when I'm here in California, is a wonderful idea. It's opening up broad perspectives to anyone who's really into music. And having a choice about what you listen to and who you listen to and who you'll pay is a wonderful, wonderful tool to have.
Mm-hmm.
And it's thanks to the internet and an open internet. And passing this would just roll us back to a model that not a lot of people were happy with to begin with.
Back to the medieval age of content distribution.
I love the idea that a lot of people are more or less talking in past tense about this older model. Do you remember a time when we had to wait for a record label to present us the new music? It's not the case anymore, and I want to keep it that way.
Well, thank you very much and for coming down here and giving your voice.
Thank you for interviewing all of us.
All right, thank you.